Retired Navy Captain Jerry Coffey considers himself an ordinary man. But when you spend 7 years in a Vietnam prison camp, surviving is a monumental achievement. Captain Coffey is an ordinary man who survived extraordinary conditions. How did he do it? In Captain Coffey's words, well, the answer is faith in myself, my fellow man, my country, and my God. I set a goal to survive and return with honor. Today, he reaffirms the invincibility of the human spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Captain Gerald Coffey.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, truly. Having served my country as a naval officer for 28 years, service of which I am very proud, just as many of you in this audience are proud of your service to our country, as you should be. But having been a prisoner of war, a POW, of course, that's a more dubious distinction. That isn't what I would have reenlisted for as a young officer back in the early 60s when I had the option, by any means. And it isn't my intention to use this wonderful opportunity that I have today to go into that POW experience on some kind of a detailed account. Because, look, I realize that for the most part, Vietnam and that whole POW issue is obsolete. For many of you in this audience, it's ancient history. And for me, in so many ways, the whole thing seems more like something that I read about in a book that happened to somebody else in his family rather than to me in mine. But it is important for us to continue to at least focus on some of the lessons and the insights that can be derived from such a unique experience. And of course, the application of those lessons in our own daily lives right here at home, personally and professionally. We find ourselves trying to navigate through some difficult and complex passages in our own personal and professional lives. Sometimes we make decisions, again, personal or professional, or maybe parenting, and we get another input, have to kind of go back and rethink the whole thing. We're surrounded by experts on every side of every issue. It's difficult sometimes to make decisions with any sense of certainty or confidence. We have to extract the lessons from our past experiences as well as from some of the people around us. Look, none of us have time to make all the mistakes to learn from ourselves. And that's where I would hope to focus our attention this afternoon, some of those lessons that can be learned. But while doing that, you know, if I don't accomplish anything else, I hope to make it so clear to each and every one of us here today how the experience from which I'll be drawing is really so much more than just my experience, or that of my friends in the other prisons and cell blocks in North Vietnam all those years, but honestly, yours as well. It doesn't matter your age, your station in life, or where you were, what you might have been doing during those particular years. Believe me, you were there with us every single day, giving us the strength and the sustenance and the will to go on. As we go along together this afternoon, maybe that will become more clear, more apparent, how that could really be. Because I'm talking about our shared experience. February 1966, my crewman and I were flying a combat reconnaissance mission from the decks of the aircraft carrier USS Kitty Hawk, flying an airplane called the Vigilante, RA-5C, fairly sophisticated, twice the speed of sound reconnaissance airplane, much like the F-14 Tomcat that we all saw Tom Cruise bopping around in the movie Top Gun. You saw Top Gun, right? That was me. Every Navy pilot thinks he's Tom Cruise, you know, flying a hot airplane, going through the streets of San Diego on his motorcycle in leather jacket and sunglasses, making out with his flight instructor. Right. As we came across the last target that day in our planned route, the airplane was hit by anti-aircraft fire. The hit itself wasn't anything spectacular, no big explosion, just kind of a thump in the after part of the airframe. But I felt it and realized we'd probably taken a hit. So I turned the airplane back toward the ocean, pushed my throttles forward into afterburner to get maximum acceleration. I wanted to get as far out to sea as possible quickly to enhance our chances of rescue by our own forces should we have to leave the airplane. We found ourselves climbing out toward the ocean, accelerating. As we did, I began to watch my hydraulic pressure gauges start to flicker and go toward zero. The warning lights were flashing on and off in the cockpit because I was losing my hydraulic fluid over the side where we'd taken that hit. An airplane like the Vigilante requires hydraulic power to steer. So as we crossed the beach going outbound, still climbing and accelerating, I watched those gauges go to zero. The control stick froze in my hand, stiff. I couldn't move it. And the airplane began to roll. And it went slowly at first, but then began to wrap up more and more rapidly. And as it did, the nose began to drop down through the horizon, still accelerating. All I could see now was the ocean spinning around in front of us. And it became clear we couldn't stay with the airplane any longer. I called to my crewman who sat behind me. I called him on the intercom. Eject, eject, eject. Didn't hear him go. Reached up and pulled the face cord in my own ejection seat, which automatically ejects him first, ready or not. Myself a split second later. By this time, because the engines are working fine, we had continued to accelerate to a speed of about 680 miles an hour. 680. Can you imagine bombing down the nearest interstate freeway close to home there in your convertible with the top down at 680? And, you know, just stand up in the front seat. Give you some small idea of the impact that high-speed ejection, and in fact, it was so severe that I was knocked unconscious immediately. If I'd never regained consciousness, I suppose, in effect, I'd know what it's like to die. That would have been my last memory. All the smoke and fumes in the cockpit from the initiation of that ejection sequence, and everything black as it hit the windstream going out. Well, I did regain consciousness, obviously, more than just by some kind of a miracle, because in my own mind, for whatever the reason, there's no question but God had his hand on my shoulder that day. When I regained consciousness, sometime later, I was floating in the water about a half a mile from the coast of North Vietnam. All of those automatic functions of my ejection seat and parachute opening device had worked properly. Unconsciously, I had released my oxygen mask, which kept me from suffocating. I released my parachute harness, which kept me from being dragged down in the water as the chute was sinking there below me. I had inflated my flotation gear, which was keeping me up in the water. Broken forearm, shattered elbow, dislocated shoulder, many cuts and burns from the impact of high-speed ejection. My crewman was about 80 yards away, inflating his own one-man rubber raft, but beyond him already were six or seven Vietnamese boats coming out toward us, army, militiamen in each boat, shooting at us with their automatic weapons and their rifles, and the bullets were literally zinging over my head and splatting on the water around me there. No aircraft overhead, no place to go or escape, and it was fairly clear that our capture was imminent, and indeed it was. The first boat reached me. They pulled me very roughly over the side and began stripping me of the survival gear I had attached to my torso harness. While that was going on, before I even realized it, some airplanes did show up in the Kitty Hawk. A couple of attack aircraft rolling in, strafing the boats, and they just picked us up, shooting at us with their 20-millimeter cannons, not realizing that we'd been picked up already and were in those very boats. I can recall pulling myself up along the shallow gunwale of the boat and watching the airplanes roll in, the bullets bracket the bow of the boat, and then the stern and the bow and the stern, rolling from both sides, strafing each pass. Finally, they broke it off about the time I reached the coast, jumped out about waist-deep surf, ran across a wide sandy beach, and dove behind a rice paddy dike to take cover, just as another aircraft rolled in and fired a pack of rockets, which blew all of those beach boats to splinters. And that was my introduction to North Vietnam. And as it turned out, sometime in that battle for our capture, in all the confusion, I couldn't keep track exactly how, but my crewman, my good friend, was killed. My captors took me northward immediately, traveling in a Russian-made Jeep kind of a vehicle over very rough and bombed-out roads, passing by, stopping at little villages and hamlets along the way, where the people out there in the countryside could somehow take out their anger and their frustration upon me, the captured U.S. air pirate, as they called us. Finally, after about 12 days of traveling, we reached the outskirts of a very large city, Hanoi, the capital of North Vietnam. We continued on down through the suburbs of Hanoi to the very heart of the city. We pulled up in front of a huge, formidable-looking fortress of a prison called Hoa Lo, which means fiery forge. We bounced through the big iron gate of Hoa Lo and through an entry tunnel. A big center courtyard opened up. Several guards took me out of the vehicle, through arched doorways and down through corridors and around to my first cell, shoved me roughly inside. A heavy wooden door slammed behind me. And a big iron bolt clanked home in the lock outside with a note of finality. And I couldn't believe this was happening to me. It's supposed to happen to the other guy, right? Never to us. But for the first time in my life, I found myself literally thrust into a totally foreign and hostile environment with no one else to turn to for advice or help or sympathy. No other source of strength except that which I was to bring in there with me, or maybe somehow find on my own. The cell in which I found myself was about this wide, 6.5 feet long. Along one wall was a concrete slab that jutted out about 20 inches, my bed, at the foot of which a set of ankle stocks, wooden on the bottom, heavy iron manacle that came down across the top and locked in place with a big rusty padlock. One tiny window very high on the back wall with a double row of iron bars, through which all I could see were the shards of filthy broken glass embedded in the concrete on top of the 16-foot wall that surrounded the entire city block-sized prison. Barbed wire stretched on top of that, of course. Small tin bucket in one corner of the cell. No lid. Supposed to take care of all my physical requirements. And I'll tell you, that old cell just reeked of the human misery that had been there before me. I mean, decades of human misery. Those earliest weeks and months when the interrogations and the extortion and the pressure were the most intense as they tried to exploit me, all of us, for military information and, of course, propaganda, I would only have enough time to get back to my cell sometimes and kind of take a big breath and lick my wounds and get ready for the next time those keys would rattle outside my cell again at the wrong time of the night. And I knew that it was my turn. I was up again. You can be sure that I prayed a lot. But I began to realize that the nature of my earliest prayers was really kind of futile, kind of useless, because I seemed to be expecting God to do everything for me rather than take enough of an active role to do something for myself. I remember one of my very first prayers was literally futile to the absurd. God, if you just give me those last 5 minutes to fly over again, I'd sure fly somewhere else, for starters. Very productive at that point. Or futile in the sense that I'd say, God, I don't care how it happens, but please let there be a military victory in the South, or maybe a political settlement, or at least a prisoner exchange. Somehow, God, get me out of here, back to my country, back to my family, because I just don't know how long I can endure in these circumstances. And if I could have possibly somehow known at the very beginning that I was going to be there for more than 7 years, I don't know what I would have done. But I began to realize and accept the fact that this might be my life for a while, whether I like it or not. And I better try to get my feet on the deck and my stuff together and get on with it and start making the most of it. And gradually the nature of my prayers began to change. And I quit saying, why me, God? And I started saying, show me, God. Show me what I'm supposed to do with this. What are you preparing me for? How am I supposed to use this experience? Help me to use it to go home, whenever that might be, as a better, stronger, smarter person in every possible way that I can, to go home as a better naval officer, to go home as a better American, to go home as a better citizen, a better Christian, to go home as a better husband and father and friend to all of my friends. God, every way, please help me to use this time productively so that it isn't just some kind of a void or a vacuum in my life. And after that realization and commitment, every day took on a new meaning, because there was purpose. There were ways to be better and smarter. There were new insights to gain about myself, about the men in the other cells around me there, about the Vietnamese communists, about the little ants and lizards that shared my cell. In fact, I paced back and forth in that short cell, 3 steps, turn, 3 steps, turn, 3. We call this the Hanoi Shuffle. You walk several miles a day that way, pacing back and forth. And as I would, it would sometimes occur to me that whenever I returned home, I don't think I ever lost hope that I would,